Hey everybody, welcome. This is Anthony Reece at VO101 here. We're going to get started in just a couple of minutes. Gonna let everybody else kind of trickle in here, and then we'll get this thing underway. I'm going to be posting to the paper, to the chat column. So I use a little chat button on the bottom of your screen there to expand out the chat window on the side. And the paper we're going to be working on today is going to be in there as a PDF. So I'll be doing that as soon as I get everybody pretty much in the system here. So hang tight. We'll get started pretty soon. Welcome again, everybody. We're going to get started in just a minute. People are still coming in. As soon as I get everybody admitted and we get underway here, I'll go ahead and attach the paper to the chat column located on the side of your Zoom window there. But let me go ahead and give everybody a couple of minutes and we'll get cranking in just a minute. So hang tight.
We also heard the recording in progress this time, too.
Hello, hello, hello. How's everybody doing?
Good, Anthony.
I heard that recording thing notify us too, Howard. So
yeah.
I was like, make sure that you remind me. We got to make sure to start that. What is a technical glitch? No, it wasn't. It was a human error. Let's accept it. So, welcome, everybody. As I said, the paper is located on the chat window. If you click the little chat icon on the bottom of the Zoom, it'll expand out that little white window on the side. And then there's the PDF of the paper. If you're on by phone and you don't have access to that at the end of the webinar, meeting, whatever you're going to call it, you can send an email to support@vo101.com. And for those of you that are watching this on demand, if you want to get a copy of this webinar's paper, you send an email to support@vo101.com. And we'll be happy to send you a paper if you're on phone or you're unable to get the paper for some reason or another. For those of you that do have access to it, open up the paper and take a look at it. You can follow along with the agenda as we go. Throughout the webinar, like typically everybody does, I'll stop and take a breath, come up for air, and give you an opportunity to click the raise your hand icon. And that'll give you the opportunity basically to ask any questions that are relevant to what we're talking about at that point in time. Try to only ask if you can information about what we're actually discussing at the moment. So this way I can stay on the agenda and hopefully not drag this out for a couple hours like I have a habit of traditionally doing, as you guys know. So get rear-winded, like they say. But anyways, we're going to get rolling. People are still clinging in, so I'm going to let them in as we go along. Once again, if you just joined us, the webinar paper is on the chat. I'm going to go ahead and load it one more time. Don't ask me why Zoom does that, but people that come in after you load it for some reason have to get the paper again. So if you see two copies on there, that's why there's two copies on there. So what are we trying to do today? Basically, what we're doing is we are discussing an area that is tomato, tomato. What I mean by that is we as voice talent in the industry, we know that our number one most important tool besides our rig and our recording quality and all the above and our website is our demo. The end of the line is demo/demos. Are must have. Do it yourself and save. Home Depot self-made demos are fine and dandy. They save you money, but they can also cost you money. And I know from experience, I can't tell you how many people have come to me and they're out there trying to figure out, why am I not making any money? What's going on? And I listen to demos and I go, did you make these demos yourself? And they go, well, yeah, you know, credit cards are maxed and all that. Well, you know, the old ROI, return on investment, you got to basically put money to make money. You got to invest in good quality demos, have a good quality website, and ultimately have a fairly decent recording rig set up. Like I talked about on LinkedIn the other day, I don't care if you're setting up your recording booth in a closet. If you're in you part your clothes, like Ben and some others have heard me say, and Howard, you can part your clothes and put a microphone stand in your bedroom closet. And if the acoustics are dead and the room's not lively, it may not look pretty. You can't showcase it. But I can guarantee you, if the mic's good, the preamp's good, and your recording levels are good, you're getting a fairly good sound that's more acceptable in the non-union world. So you don't have to spend several thousand dollars on a nice recording booth if you don't have intention of commercially utilizing that booth. To cosmetically make it look like, yeah, look at me, look at my dig. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. That's totally cool. That helps in the wow factor as well. But the reality is invest in demos. Demos, and I'm not trying to sell you. Well, I am, but I'm not. Demos are a must. I've probably got personally, and I've been doing this since the dinosaurs roamed. I've been doing this since probably the mid 80s when I was in high school or in the rock and roll era, hippie freak days, the hairband era. I've probably got 55 to 65 demos, and I'm not joking you. Of those demos, some of them are 25 and 30 years old. Most of those, 15 or 20 of my core demos are 5 years or newer. I constantly update my demos as often as I can. to freshen up my sound so that I share my demos with a network of other demo producers that I'm in bed with. They are not only producers, demo producers, but they're content creators, and they're fairly high up the scale on the A-list level. And we share our demos back and forth and productions and things that we do for others' talent so we can get feedback from one another. So you could call it a quality control environment. Unlike as a talent, that can kind of be not a good idea. You really don't want to share your demos and get opinions and feedback and all the above with too many other chefs. Every chef likes more salt. Some chefs like curry. Some chefs like jalapeno. Some chefs like it bland. Some chefs are half deaf because of 30 years at all the massive decibel levels you can think of next to the Marshall amps on stage. I can tell you I've worked on album projects over the years, and I go to think about the producer and I'm going, man, that dude's ears are fried. So be careful that you don't go out there and let too many opinions sway your eye on the prize. So invest in good quality demos. That's my sales pitch. At the end of the webinar, I'm offering $100 off to anybody that wants to have a demo developed. On a package of 2, 3, 4, and or 5, my packages, I'm offering $100 off. You have to contact me at student or at support at VO101 to get that. I don't publish it on the site, and I don't have it as a coupon. You have to contact, and then I will offer it to you and make arrangements for you to pay outside at a different location, if you will, through PayPal. So let's get rolling what the philosophy is. So what we're going to talk about first is the first thing I'm going to talk about is what's on the top of the paper, the reading. Uncover the new approach to voiceover demos, picking the right industry categories, diverse voice sounds, registers, textures, vocal ranges, tempos, and more. Plus, why great production volume is a must. I can bang heads with everybody out there. Some producers think I'm nuts. Other producers say, I totally agree with you. Some talents say, what? Give me a break. It's my voice that matters. I'm telling you right now, we'll talk about that in a minute. That's untrue. Debunk the old school myths and ways of thinking to compete in the 21st century. You're in a much younger demographic, millennial-driven industry. Don't fall victim to the old ways of thinking about voiceover demos. Now, what do I mean off that? We'll talk about these things and see if any of these myths are things that you guys think, have thought, have been told. And I'll open up the mic, if you will, in a few minutes. We'll hands talk about these ideas, and then we'll go back into the process of developing a really good quality demo or demos. The first thing that I hear from people all the time is, do you still believe your demos are for your agents, or are your demos really for your prospects? Now, what do I mean by that? Agents hate me and the agents love me. Some agents in LA, New York, Chicago, Miami, Dallas, I can name it, overseas, London, Israel, all over the world, they send their people to me and I do demos with them. I help them develop stuff. Yes, even in languages that I don't speak, I can still tell what is a good read and what is good delivery. It doesn't have to be necessarily in English. The reality is we as talent get stuck in the old school 70s and 80s and early 90s mindset that our demos have to please our agent. The demos land you an agent. They don't please the agent. If you're developing your demos to impress your agent, well, is your agent guaranteeing you the job? No, the client and the prospects who gives you the job. The agent's a facilitator. Like me and other casting people, our job is paid with a middleman. We're to take you and then connect you with the client by sharing the client your information, who you are, your demos, etc. Now, if your agent is saying, well, all I really care about is your voice, throw a little music under it, and that's all we need. Run. I'm telling you, I don't care what they think about me. Run. Because their prospects, your clients, that guy smoking ganja down in the Caribbean who's casting for his next whatever, that girl or guy in Australia, that producer in Canada, that guy down in Miami, that person at Funimation, that guy at Comcast, that girl at Cox, they could care less what the agent thinks. That's who you got to win over. Who you got to win over is ultimately me, the casting director, me, the content producer. That's who you got to wow. The agents are fine. If the agent wants you to develop, well, I really want to just hear a couple dry clips, then contact your producer, like me or whoever you work with, and have them develop a dry voice-only montage of 5 to 6 clips, 60 seconds long, and send that back to you, and you can send that to your agent. If your agent believes in that, do not put all your marbles in that one basket. If you're signed exclusively, you better be union. And if you aren't signed exclusively, and you are not union, and you're going to sign exclusively, they better guarantee you they're going to keep you working, or you need to exit quick. Unless they guarantee they're going to give you a certain amount of money, don't sign exclusively. So you're not necessarily trying to create demos and hire me and the other guys and all the other guys out there to develop demos based on, okay, now what does your agent think? I could care less what the agent thinks. Yeah, what does your grandmother think about my chili? With all the respect, it's my chili. It's our chili we made together. Yeah, grandma probably has her own recipe. But the reality is, what matters is, are we putting together a killer chili? And the ultimate job is, we're trying to land you clients, prospects, and gigs. We're not trying to land you agents who then just sit back and you starve to death. And they're happy. Oh, I love that demo. Well, they get me some work. Well, I'm trying. How about if you use this for a while? Let's try it my way for a while and see what happens. This is 2022. This isn't 1980. This isn't 1970. We are not big fish in little ponds, right? We are competing globally. We're competing with people that can afford high quality, fully produced environments. And a lot of these softwares and all these stock everything websites, and if they can build their own demos these days and be competitive, but yet people that are like me and others that are in the business, we know when somebody has developed their own. The reason is, we'll talk about, there's a madness to why the train cars are lined up down the track in certain order. There's a reason why in radio we program the hour, and in TV we program the hour, keeping the consumer locked in to keep them around. We don't put it all up front. We bury stuff at the 20, 35 break, at the 50 break, at the 20 break. In the clock, it's the same concept as programming a radio hour, program a TV hour. When we're developing shows, we program Ancient Aliens a certain way. When we are developing a demo, we program the clips in a certain order, dependent on the strength and all the stuff we'll talk about in a few minutes here. So that's the biggest thing I'm going to tangent on, is you build demos for prospects, for clients, for marketing, not just for your agent. And if the agent is the priority one, you got to bass hackers, as we say. The agent is not going to make or break you getting work. It's the demo and the client liking what they hear and are blown away. The second thing is, do you think the demo should be 60 seconds? That kind of falls into what we're talking about. Back in the day, and again, I bang heads with people, but too bad. Back in the day, the reason that the demos were what they were, remember where I came from. I've been in this business since before broadband kicked in. I was sharing demos by CD and cassette back in the pre-dial-up days. Okay, that's how long I've been in it, since I was a kid. We used to develop demos and their WAV files. MP3 had not kicked in yet. So our WAV files were monstrous. We couldn't dial up a 56 dial up, whatever modem it was. And it would take forever to connect. And then it would take like an hour and a half to 2 hours to send an 8 meg WAV file. All right. So we had to mail everything on disk. Thank God MP3 and ISDN and all that came along. But the reality is, and hello, agent, whoever you are watching this, I'm not going to give my address, so don't bomb me or whatever. The reality is, if I'm an agent and I have 15 minutes of time with client X on the phone, or client X comes to my my studio, my agency, and I got 15, 20 minutes of his or her time, and I got 75 to 150 talent on my voice roster. And I don't favor any one of them particularly, even though they all have their pet peeves, like teachers do, et cetera. Who am I going to, what am I going to do? Am I going to utilize that 15 minutes, letting you eat up 3 or 4 minutes of that? Or am I going to utilize that 15 minutes to show them 15 or 20 of my talent? It's a no-brainer. It's common sense when you think about it. I want that demo to be, we're in 30 to 40 or 50 seconds, if not 60, we can say, well, what do you think? Okay, well, here's the next guy. Bang. Oh, what do you think of her? All right, well, here's the next girl. Bang. We got their attention for a certain amount of time, so we have to hurry through as quick as we can. If you believe of the mindset that they will make a decision in 15 or 20 seconds or 30 seconds, you need to find a new demo producer. If your demo has everything you're about in the first 2 or 3 or 4 clips of your demo, run as fast as you can out the door to a new demo guy. The reality is that demo should make them want to listen through the end. That demo should have enough variation, as Pete will testify, who I just built one with, and Ben and some others. That demo is to make them, the TSL, longer. That means the time spent listening. If they can tell in 15 or 20 seconds, like everybody in the industry tries to sell, and I don't agree with them, never have. I've always been that black sheep, the outsider. That's why. Wait, I'm supposed to believe they're going to hire me off of my 60-second demo that I send you because that's the max. No, it's because they want to show as many talent off as they can in the 15 minutes they have. Two, they want to real quickly let the client make a decision in 15 or 20 seconds, 30 seconds maybe. Maybe in an audition environment, I can see that because you only get that one audition. You're supposed to do what they're looking for, cut a track, send it to them, and hope you get the gig or callback. Even in the audition environment, some of you are students and have been students with me. Even old dogs that I refresh and reteach the new tricks of the day, you want to send 3 clips, 3 variations. If they don't say, hey, you know, do me a favor, send me 1 take only, send them 3 stretch your out rule. Send them the one they want, followed right away by a second interpretation, followed right away by your third, here's my opinion type of a piece. This way, if they hear them, which they typically will, they're going to go, you know, I like the variety of sounds here. I'm kind of confused now. I kind of like what this guy or their girl did on the third take that we weren't looking for. Most talent will send 1 take. They'll even slay it ahead of time, which is a no-no in these days. I tell everybody 3 clips, 3 takes, but variations, and we'll talk about that a little bit. So in 15 or 20 seconds, if you think, honestly, a client is going to know off your demo if they like you, then you need to find a new demo producer. Because I can tell you right now, in the first 30 seconds of the demos that I make, the first 30 to 45 seconds, that person has gone, what the? Because they're all over the place. I purposely build my demos so that they're on a roller coaster ride. Now, that philosophy of they know what you want in 30 seconds or less, maybe in the audition stage, I can understand that. But in the demo phase, negative. And if you think, honestly, that you are going to have somebody judge you off of 45 seconds or 60 seconds, and you can show them everything that you can do in that quick of time, you're doing a very quick sizzle, what I just did with Pete, for example. Your sizzle reel has to be 4 or 5 second bites. Boom, 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 boom. In the radio world, keep going back to broadcasting, is these are called sizzle reels because they're air checks. They're basically what we send to the program director. If we're doing middays at Hot 105 and we want to go to B93 and we want to wow over the PD, we're showing him clips or her clips that make them go, wow, this guy's really hot. If they're quick, fast, bang, 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 all over the place, we wow them. We're wow factoring them. That's what you got to do in a 60-second reel. If you're developing a 60 and you're developing a 75, that reel had better be moving fast, and better show as much of yourself as you can in that 60 seconds. Because if that agent is only giving you that window of time, then utilize it. Utilize that real estate the best you can. And that doesn't mean 4, 15, or 20 second clips. That means a half a dozen to a dozen, if not more, 5 second bites that make them go. Now, the other philosophy, and I won't tangent, but the other philosophy is, well, you know, all they care about is your money voice. Money voice? Yeah, back in the day, me and Bill and Mitch and everybody, we had our money voice because we are the big fish in Dallas. There was only 7 of us in the entire Southwest, Southeast. Not no more. There's big fish everywhere. And the reality is we are not a name that you can sell and we can get whatever we want because you have no other choices. I can get on right now and in 10 minutes have 20 auditions, 50 auditions sent to me that quick. And they're all good. And the reality is you have to think of it like that. You're competing in a market of where you've got to be able to be different. You've got to show variety. You've got to show diversity. You've got to show that you're not just a one-dimensional sounding talent, that you can offer a smorgasbord, as those of you that work with me, train with me know. You got to show you are a buffet. What do you need? By the way, here's what I normally sound like, if you'd like to hear my normal voice. People are going to go, I heard enough. I'm good. I'm blown away. The old days of having that money voice is why we starved to death as talent. If people want to hear your money voice, then after about third clip, 15, 20, 30 seconds, then what happens is they go, yeah, I know what he sounds like. Yeah, I know what she sounds like, because every clip pretty much is the same. It may be a different product, project, whatever. But if your sound is right in that middle and everything is in that middle one dimension of your voice, the middle register, the middle texture, the flat sound, the one color as I teach, if you're right there, they know what you are all about in 15 or 20 seconds. But guess what? The beauty of being in 2022 is we don't want them to think they know what you're all about. We want to keep them guessing. We want them to go, oh my God, I want people at the end of my demos, and it's worked over the years, to go, I don't know what the frick to hire now. I don't know what to have him do. I like everything I hear. Then I can bring them back to reality and say, okay, so what clip of my demo by the second mark do you like the closest to what you're looking to do? We like it a minute, 10 seconds. Very good. Bang. It's like a country buffet. They walk in, they go, I don't know if I want French, Japanese, do I want a salad, do I want Mexican, do I want a steak area, do I just want to eat ice cream? You can do whatever you want. Guess what? Welcome to my country buffet. So that's what I mean by don't believe the philosophy of 60 seconds or less. Don't believe that they will judge you in 20 seconds or 30 seconds. In an audition, maybe, but in a demo environment, never. Okay, do you still believe that, let's see, do you still whisper in the ear of your lawyer? In other words, do you whisper in the ear of your lawyer what to say in court? Or do you let them do what they're hired to do? If you're a talent, like I've been, if you're a voice talent, you let your producer, who you hire, who you built a trust in, if they know what they're doing and they've got a resume and they've got experience and they've proven they've got a track record, they're new and they're not just all of a sudden showing up on LinkedIn that they're now a producer. If they're legitimate and they've got a history and a track record and you hear their stuff and you know they know what they're doing and their philosophy is more than just, let's put you over music. Here's $6,000, please. Then what are you doing trying to second guess them? You got to trust your lawyer. If the lawyer doesn't do a good job for you when it's all said and done, then next time you hire a different law firm. But meanwhile, you don't whisper in the ear, well, so-and-so, my friend, she studied law back in high school, and she told me you should be, then why aren't you working with your friend? Then go to your friend. And yes, maybe I'm going, huh, a little bit, but I have a few people that I've worked with over the years who come to me and I can tell they went to their neighbor or they went to a guy who owns a recording studio, or they went to a house engineer that runs some club's PA system, and he's an expert on voiceovers and demos. And they went to all these people, their improv group, their theater coach, they went somewhere else, and another chef told them, there's not enough salt in here. You know, this has way too much pepper. Then guess what? Go to their kitchen and learn to cook. Don't go to a producer. I don't care who they are. When you know the names, I could drop from the big guns to middle of the road guys like us. Don't go to them and try to then stew, mess with the pot by giving them feedback that you've collectively got from everybody else. You don't allow the backseat driver to take control of the car. If he's driving or she's driving, let them do their job. If they're good and they're competent, and I know a few that are, and I know a few that I would avoid like the plague, the reality is if they know what they're doing and you're doing a good job with them, then you'll end up with a good product. But you have to trust that they know there's a reason why they're telling you it's okay to do what you're doing and it's not okay. Because if it's not okay, I would expect ethically for them to say, no, trust me, I don't want to explain everything to you, but trust me, you don't want to do that. The next thing, do you think your voice should always be the star? Kind of what I'm talking about here. Do you honestly believe that the production value doesn't matter? Well, let's put it like this. Production value matters. If you are developing a demo and you're trying to demonstrate to prospects and clients and agents and casting directors and whatever, that you are an experienced veteran in the business, then you better more than likely, wink, wink, have stuff in the can. In other words, if you've been out there a while, then can I hear some of the other stuff you've done? We are, in a way, developing mock demos to fake it till we make it. Let's face it, we're all in this together. Not all of us that are in the business as voice artists have 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, 7 years, hundreds of things in the can that we can pick and choose. I like that one. I like that one. If we do, almost all of it's dry. Very rarely, unless you are willing to follow up, do you ever get sent a final edit mixed and produced in a commercial ready to go from your client. You literally, a lot of times, have to chase the client and say, remember that project I did for you last month for that auto dealer, that commercial? Can I get a copy of that? Or you have to go to YouTube and type it in and link it to your channel or whatever, right? So the reality is, majority of talent that come to me, and you'd be shocked how many of them have been in business several years in LA and Burbank and New York, who come to me and say, I don't know what to do, man. I've tried contacting some of my clients. Half of them are out of business. I can't put together enough content that I've worked on. Don't worry. Let's build stuff that sounds like it's content. That's the purpose for the production value. Production value not only makes you look great if it's well produced and it's a powerful spot, but production value also is a way to, I guess, the say it nicely, bullshit the bullshitters. It's a way to develop a commercial and a narration and an audiobook sample and a telephone sample and a character sample that sounds like it was derived from somebody's project. Now, does everybody produce at the same studio in America and around the world? No. Does everybody use the same producer? No. Is everybody a graduate from Full Sail? No. Are a lot of producers at most of your production houses self-taught? YouTubers? Yes. So what I'm saying is every single mix, other than leveling it and re-EQing it, mastering it, should be mixed and EQ'd and mastered a little bit differently. Not enough to where it's like, wow, what happened? How do you go from there to there to there to there? But so that there's a consistency that is inconsistent at the same time. And what I mean by that is there are some producers who like to put a little candy on the voice. There are some producers that like to put compression and make your voice big and full. All right, the Don LaFontaine sound or the Hal Douglas or the trailer voice. Get what I'm saying? There are the producers who are half deaf, who have all high-end mixed The reason that we purposely go through and I re-EQ each clip a little differently and then build it all out, master it all at one level and everything, one mastering, is so that it doesn't sound so different that it's like, what the heck? But that it sounds different enough so that if you are a prospect who has an ear, you can tell these sound like they're all from products they've done. If you're a producer and you're a prospect who has an ear, we can tell in a heartbeat if you hired a producer, he or she put music under there, buried it back in the background, threw an occasional dog bark or occasional doorbell, and that's the effect. That's the sound effects, the SFX. That's the ear candy. That's your production value. Now they put you right up front, and every clip is the same. Yep, it's a studio-made demo, and that's fine. If that's what you think is going to get you landing gigs, is that studio demo, then you might as well save yourself $1,000 and do that at home. There's stock music all over the internet, free, that you can get out there. There's stock sound effect websites. You can download a dog barking, put it in your Audacity on track 3, put your music on track 4, put your voice on track 1, level off, mix it, check, you're done, if that's what you want. But I can tell you right now, I don't know of hardly anybody in the business who really lands gigs from those type of demos. They may sound great and they may make you feel like, wow, this is clean. I'm the star. Listen to me. But the reality is real prospects and producers go, what? This is obviously self-made, studio hired, made stuff. Now, not everybody is going to agree with me here and people that watch this on demand and people that come to me. But that's my philosophy. Mark has his philosophy. Ed has his. I can go on down the road. Everybody has their philosophy. But the reality is most of us have it because we've been there and did it, and we know it works. We trialed and erred, and we know what works and what doesn't work. We know what, as they say, you know, bullshit walks and talks, as they say, whatever. We know what really sells. And what we want to do is talent, is make sure our producer wows that listener, wows that viewer, to the point of where they go, man, that's not only is that person great, but the mix is hot and rocking, man, smoking, as they say. Why does that benefit you and me as talent? Because it just makes us look like we're part of a powerful finished spot. We're not the star. The music is, where's the music? Oh, there it is. Okay. Well, that's what my everybody tells me to do. My friend next door, who used to be in radio in 1983, you know, no. You want stuff that kicks butt. It's simply put, if that was true, why isn't every musical song in the world, the vocalist all the way up front and the music buried off in the back? Ask Bob Rock that. Ask Mutt Lange that. Ask all the other Grammy-winning producers why. The reason is production value. Production value in demos, no different. Production value in TV is no different. Production value at radio is no different. When I used to produce tons and tons of nightclub stuff back in the day, my clients would come to me and they would say, turn up the music, man. And I'd go, but I'm trying to be really conservative. Don't let the hair fool you. I'm like, turn up the music, man. I want the speakers to rattle. I want them to feel it in their chest, man. I'm telling you, it works. Look at Motley Crue music. Look at anybody you want, Metallica. That stuff pounds in your chest. There's a reason that we do that. It's because it's body candy. It's ear candy. And when we're producing demos for the 2022 era in the 21st century, we have one shot, as Eminem says, to seize the moment and lose yourself and kick butt. And if you lose them because you're basically a classical symphonic sounding, you know, with barely any music, and you're very conservative sounding, and your demo is, I'm telling you right now, she sounds great, really good, nice. Let me hit the next one. We want them to go, I don't need to hear any more. I love everything I heard. This person's all over the place. And man, wow factor. That's what it's called, the wow factor. The next couple things, I'll blast through them. Do you think the production SX sound mix have the wow factor we just talked about? Do you still think the demo should never feature other voices? And even if they're not voice artists, I just had this discussion with somebody the other day. feedback was, well, I was told there should be any other voices in my demo. That's true, probably. The way of thinking is, if you're a female, you shouldn't be bouncing off a male, all right? If you're a male, you shouldn't be bouncing off the female. That's true. You don't want to necessarily highlight other voice artists on your reel. But if you're doing a commercial and there is a customer in the commercial, or you're doing a commercial and it's a little kid or a testimonial or a production value voice, are you trying to say that you shouldn't have any of that in your demo? What? That would mean your entire video archive of all the commercials you've ever done and all the narrations and all the anything you've ever done, we have to go through and cut out every single one of the other people that are on camera? That's crazy. To even think that anybody would say, well, make sure there's no other voice-related content is nuts. And I'll argue until the cows come home on a panel with anybody who wants to debate that. What it comes down to is you're the star, if you will. And if you're feeding on a commercial off of a testimony about a hurricane, and then it comes back to you, and we're showing that 15-second TV clip or whatever, and there's one lady in tears crying or one political person speaking, and then you come back in, that is production value. That is making it sound like it's realistically a derived commercial, a narration, audiobook, or whatever have you. If you are bouncing off you, and then a male, and then a female, and then you, yes, then the prospect or the consumer can go, wait a minute, which one is her? Wait, which one? He's which one? What voice is he, a third voice? Then, yeah, I agree with that. And I always have, ever since I've been in this thing. I agree totally with that. But you want to also consider building down the road demos for that educated client that you're working with who says, do you have anything that shows you playing off other actors? You want to have that reel eventually. You eventually want to be able to let people hear what you sound like working off other actors. There's a reason for that. We want to know, do you understand ending inflections? Do you understand handoffs? Do you understand how to work with other talent, not necessarily live in the booth with them? Can you set up your lines so that every line, as Howard knows and Ben and others that have trained with me that I haven't looked at everybody yet, do you understand how to make your line in an audition sound like it's setting up the next cast member? So that when they drop your voice into an audition, and the audition, you are one of three voices in that commercial, are you leaving your voice, your clip hanging, so that when it works off the next person, your voice sounds like you were together in a booth somewhere? Or is everything an ending inflection? Is everything a period mark? Is everything a downward inflection? These are things that advanced casting directors, we listen for, we look for. Not everybody in the non-union world gets to be on Source Connect or ISDN or gets to link up and be patched in anymore. Union, yes, most of the time you go in the studio if you're not already linked up. But non-union talent, majority of us talent out there, have to develop our lines and send them in a batch to somebody. So you want to think about it when you're looking at a script. Am I leaving my line so that it's handing off? And that is a very important part of, yes, you want to have some production in your demo if it's called for, not by design, but if it's called for and me or whoever produces, and we want to potentially show you, the hurricane hit with full force, but we are there to help that person. I was starving to death and freezing to death, and they were there for me. So we went in. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with bookcasing front and back test of a testimonial in your clip. But do you want to have yourself necessarily work off another talent on your demo? Probably not. So that is where that confusion lies. And I want to clear that up because a lot of people believe, well, there shouldn't be any voice in my demo. Can you edit all them out? Who said that? Well, my neighbor, he was on radio in 83. What? No. Do you find landing jobs is pulling your teeth, literally like pulling your teeth, because you're using old school demos? I can tell you right now, some hate me, some love me, some don't want to hear what I have to say, some bang heads with me, some totally agree. Tomato, tomato. There are a lot of talent, and I'm a talent. That's what I teach from the street, and I'm teach from corporation. I'm a talent because I've been there, did that, and then some. And the reality is, talent are out there starving, and they're going, well, maybe if I buy a better microphone. Well, maybe if I just build a bigger booth. Well, maybe if I just spend $3,000 and re-insulate my garage better. No, maybe you should get better training. Maybe you should build better demos. Maybe you should invest in yourself here, not the tools that are, who cares? Like I said, it comes down to people are developing demos and it drives me crazy. And they're working with demos that are old school demos for millennials that are 25 years old, 30 years old. For boys and girls that are old enough to be my child and some of your children, right? These are kids that grew up with a phone attached to them. These are people that grew up with YouTube, Facebook, and all that, and Instagram and Pinterest, which is now going to the younger generation. It used to be old mom and dad saying Pinterest back in the day. All right. Look what's happening at Twitter with Elon about to buy it up, probably. All right. People are starting to wake up and realize, wait a second. In order to be a competitive voice talent and you are going to get cast, your agent may be 60, 50 years old. They may have been a product of the 80s. They may have been in the hairband era. They may be left over from the 70s. All right. But the person making the decision at EA Sports, at Funimation, at Cox, at Comcast, and like Time Warner and Pixar, and I can get on the list, they are typically 25, 28 to 30, 32, if that, millennial age, Gen Z or whatever that whole era is. What does that mean? They're socially savvy. They're smarter. You can't just impress them with your voice anymore. You have to impress them with, wow, that's an awesome sound, or man, listen to that mix, or I love that music beat. All that stuff is part of the overall demo. It has to be able to kick butt. And if you're going to go out there with old school made demos, I can tell you right now, I make them for people all the time that are using old school demos. And within weeks, if not months, they come back to me or they email me and say, I finally landed 2 jobs this month. I haven't landed a job in a year. And the reason is they're entering the market with a whole new prospect and a whole new outlook, a fresh sound, a current sound. It's simply put as that, demos for the 21st century. And the reality is a lot of talent, they don't want to change the ways they're comfortable with. Well, I spent $7,000 on that demo, what, 10 years ago? You know, for $1,000 now, we can kick butt and develop an excellent quality demo. And that demo is going to take you for the next 5 or 6 or whatever years. I can't stress enough, as I do with everybody, if you're going to keep going on the same old song is dance, right? How the song goes, you're going to have the same old return, ROI, return on investment, return on yourself by building good quality demos with me, with whoever you choose to go with your cousin Luigi, with Aunt Mary's granddaughter who just graduated in Orlando at Full Sail, who's a great little producer or whatever. But make sure that you know these are the things that I want to make sure that we do, which we'll talk about not as windy, but in the next part of this as we go into now, how do you really approach it? What are the things you want to think about? So if you got any questions for me relevant to these, feel free to click on the raise your hand and I'll go down the list and let you ask some questions about any of these topics we just discussed, these myths, if you will, hopefully myth busters, as we say. So feel free to go for it. Pete, I see you there, Pete.
Hey, how you doing?
Go ahead, Pete.
One thing that occurs to me during what you've been saying, Anthony, is that with such a highly produced demo as you made for me, I mean, it's just outstanding. What if they come back to me and they say, wow, I really like your demo. Can you do that for me? You know, it's like, I don't have that facility. I mean, it's like, do I call you and say, Anthony, I got to do this by, you know, in 2 hours or by midnight tomorrow or something like that.
So you mean, in other words, they are blown away by what they hear, whoever the demo was produced by, and the client says, I'm interested in having you develop my commercial or my whatever?
Well, you know, I think what I'm thinking is that I have a friend of mine who used to be a DJ ever since the 70s.
Right.
And I heard one of his demos not too long ago. And I mean, like, it was more like a sizzle, you know.
Right.
And,
right.
And I'm pretty sure because of his experience, like yourself, you know, he probably put it together himself.
Right.
You know, I don't have that kind of background.
Yeah, most of the product that you're going to, as you know, having been in this a while, most of the voice work we do is going to be 8 out of 10 times, if not more, 9 out of 10, for a content developer, a videographer, an animator, a broadcaster, an audiobook creator, producer, whatever they happen to do. So they typically will take care of developing that track, that project. All they're really hiring you for is the voice part of it.
Right.
And your demo... The reason that I push people like I do to step out of their comfort zone, like Howard and others know, lower, middle, upper registers, like Jason knows and others, the reason I push people to go on the different registers and work the different registers is so that you can't deliver the goods, whatever they need. If they need, if they need a higher energy spot, by you knowing how to deliver a higher energy spot now, because we developed that technique, training, and or in the demo process, they're going to be looking for the energy or the style of your voice that we're going to talk about here in a few minutes. They're not necessarily going to be looking to hire you for the content creation.
Okay.
Now, if they are a mom and pop and they are going, putting out there, looking for voice talent themselves, but they really don't have a producer yet, then that is where... Some people moonlight as audio producers on the side. They don't promote it necessarily, or they do video work, or they're animators or graphic designers or copywriters. There's your chance when they open up the door to say, well, I actually can develop a product for you. 9 times out of 10, you're not going to run into that in a voice casting environment. You're going to be casting your voice for a project they're going to produce and develop and work with somebody else to do. So,
okay.
Good question. Cool. I see where you're coming from.
Thank you. Thank you very
much. No problem, man. All right. So let's see, who anybody else want to ask anything about any of this? I think I made it pretty clear. So, okay, I looks like we're good to go on that. Let me go ahead and see anybody else. Last calls, and we'll go on to the next section here real quickly. All right, great. All right, so let's go ahead and move on. And if you change your mind, raise your hand at any point here. Okay, so how do you really go about building a good demo? What is it you want to accomplish? The first thing you want to do is you want to know what your desired genre is. Simply put, if you are developing a commercial demo, a narrative demo, audiobook demo, character demo, an imaging demo, if you're developing a any kind of a demo that is like a how-to, explainer video, anything that is genre-specific, what it falls into what I call master genres: commercials, narrations, characters, imaging, the 5 primary genres we work in for the most part. Then you want to select the proper standard categories that fall under that genre, what I call basically the subgenre categories. The subgenre categories are, for example, in commercials, automotive, retail, fast food, floral, jewelry, travel, recreation, healthcare, medical, financial, credit, online shopping, pet supplies, etc. How do I know that? You're asking yourself that. Flip on your TV, be a consumer, work it through Sling, work your way through Comcast or cable or satellite or dish or whatever you have, and don't pay attention to shows, pay attention to commercial subsets. What's airing? What's in the market? Regionally and nationally, you're going to find those that are primary subgenres. If you're developing a commercial of demo, you want your producer to know, I got to show you off in automotive. I got to show you off in all of the subgenre categories. The reason is your prospects are potentially, probably 75, 85% of those prospects are doing one of those subgenres. If they're a TV producer or a radio producer, or they're developing a gateway ad for YouTube, or they're developing electronic media, as we call it, advertising, they're typically going to be one of those subgenres based on the commercial industry. The narrative industry has the same way. Narration category has underneath it technical, right? Medical / pharmaceutical. They have training. We have education. We have how-tos. We have documentary. We have, you can think of those subgenres that fall under the category of narrative. Your narrative demo should reflect your ability to deliver the different sounds from the different subgenres, as I teach, underneath the narrative main primary genre. If your demo is developed by somebody and he has put a little bit of stuff that's landed more towards documentaries, or he has put way a bunch of stuff that has to do with finance and brokerage, and only a few other categories have been selected right. You got to put thought into it when you're creating scripts and you're developing scripts, what those are, and the primary reason is that's the target consumer market. If you're after a narration company and they are after a narrator, typically they are looking for somebody to do one of the above: a technical product, a pharmaceutical medical product, you get where I'm going with that. So you want to make sure that your subgenre categories are selected properly. That's the second thing you're going to think about. The third thing you think about is, okay, do I have any on-hand content that is worthy? Not that you think is, oh, that sounds so great, all right? You got to remove yourself emotionally. You can't be personally emotionally connected with yourself. You got to be objective. So take off your talent hat and put on your objective casting gal hat, and think, are these product clips that I'm thinking of using worthy? Or are they, yeah, well, it's something. No, that something can cost you a job. Is it worthy? And 9 times out of 10, who you're producing with should be the one to make that decision with you. Not for you, but with you. And you should, unless you're hands on a control freak, they should have the veto power. They should have the old veto power to say, nah, it's going to hurt you more than scalp you. Your enunciation is bad. The mix is terrible. The quality is way old. Sounds like it's from back in the cassette era. They don't have an HD quality. They got to have the right to basically overrule a veto, as we say, so that they can basically decide what's best for you. You know, part of being a parent, if any of you are parents, part of being a parent is sometimes you have to be the bad cop. Sometimes you can't say, yeah, sure, honey, no problem. Go ride your bike backwards with no helmet on. Let me get my phone. you gotta sometimes say, what are you, insane? Put your helmet on and turn yourself around on that bike. That's a stupid analogy. And I've been there, having raised 4 kids. But I understand when I work with talent and I work with producers and I train people, even when we're doing a reading and I say, you said ta, say today. Yeah, but I heard the other day on the commercial, he said ta. Well, he said ta, but you get in the habit of saying today. It's pronounced today. It's not today. It's not get yours. It's get yours. And all the people that have worked with me there here are watching in or now will laugh because they'll hear this in their sleep from me. It's all about good enunciation. So when you pick your stuff, does it represent you? As they say on the street, my boys in their 20s say, does it give you street cred? You know, it gives me street cred, man. You know, well, does that clip give you cred? And if it does, it goes in the possible the pending pool, that bin, that folder that you zip up and you send, we transfer, or you drop or whatever, you send to your prospective producer, and we or he or she decide, yeah, that will be included. I like that. That'll work for us in that character or that narrative demo or that whatever commercial demo. You want to consider that product you have on hand. If you don't have content worthy, or not enough content, which almost everybody doesn't, then you want to develop good, effective scripts that represent, again, what we just talked about in the subcategories under each one of those genres. And there is a madness to why we write the script and say the things we say in the script. People think, oh, it's just a go on the internet and I can cut and paste and cut and paste. No, you gotta actually write things. Even if it's only a couple lines, which is typically what we use in a 20-second clip, give or take, a couple lines, all right? so that it's actually got certain buzzwords and keywords and usage of the verbiage so that it will hopefully make the consumer, the prospect that you're looking at landing, feel like these are strong, effective words. The copy is professionally written, the script are professionally written. And it's not incredibly important, but once again, tomato, tomato, you know, detail or not attention to detail. But I recommend really good quality, small, two-line, give or take three-line clips. Now that you know what genre, what subgenre, what you have on hand, what clips you need to create by writing and putting together a list of the clips, and then writing a script for each one of those clips. Now that you have the script, you rehearse the script until you own it. Strive to work out every word until you can almost recall the script from memory. Your goal is to not sound read. Your goal is to make sure everything flows like you know it, like you wrote it, wink, wink, like you own it, as I teach my students. Owning it means you sound like you know the product, because then your confidence and your competence, as my students know what I'm talking about, they go hand in hand. The prospect, the client who listens to your demo, the casting director, a couple of guys smoking ganja in a dorm, a woman who runs a training course, a man who runs a training course, whatever they are, wherever they are somewhat educated and savvy, and they know, do you know what you're talking about? Can I tell you know what you're doing? If I'm hiring you for Liberty University or DeVry or Harvard or law school types, do I think my student will believe you? Do you know what you're talking about? You got to sound like you're in the know. And the key is that only comes with rehearsing it. I can't tell you how many demos that I've listened to, and I do reviews all week long for people. I get like at least 7 to 10 evaluations a week that I do for people. And every one of the demos that I hear, some are well produced. Some are like, obviously, give me a break. I mean, where's the, there's no music. The biggest thing that I run into is they sound like they read the script. They sound like they're literally holding the script in front of the mic and reading it. And we call that not sounding read. The reality is you got to sound like you know what you're doing. Only then can you truly deliver to me or another producer a well-read, good performance. And once you deliver a well-read, good performance, we can produce the you know what out of it, make you sound like a rock star. If you can't sing that song because it sounds like you're reading the lyrics, I don't care who you are in the studio, the producer can't make you sound like a rock star. You have to be able to be believable. So the most important thing next is to rehearse until you're sick and tired of it to the point of where you can say it at the dinner table and drive the kids nuts. Use various registers and voice tones. The sound of every clip should be unique and diverse to assure the final demo shows a range of your voice and styles within the genre. Strive to be not to be one-dimensional. And Pete and others will testify what I'm talking about there. That's why his demo's all over the place. You purposely want a producer who's going to force you to use your lower register. Okay, now give me this clip in an upper. Each one of the individual directives that are given with each clip should say, use your lower tone, think aggressively. Use your upper register, be lighter and happier. Use more of a brighter, fun feel. Think outdoors, happiness. They should give you some form of direction so that the stage direction is like you're getting from a typical audition. This way, every clip that you develop that builds into a demo eventually will sound like a series of everything you've done over the years for clients, not like one voice demo developed in the same day at the same sound, the same feel, the same everything. Even I talk about, as I say in there, vocal tones, lower, middle, upper, inflections, casual, business, corporate, like I teach, excited, urgent inflections, laid back stuff, more aggressive stuff, higher energy, call to action stuff. You want to show diversity so that your demo pops. I don't care if it's a commercial demo, a narrative demo, an audiobook, a character demo, imaging, especially when I work with imaging guys, your demo should pop. not just production value, not just good quality recording sound overall, but your performance should pop. And by using those different tones and those different registers and making sure every clip has a different movement, that's important. Move your words like they are musical notes within the genre. Strive to not be one-dimensional. And then it says below it, move your words like they are musical notes with different values of time. Your reed should not should have life and movement to create a cadence. Use patterns and rhythm. The days of being wooden and stiff are of the past. If you're one-dimensional, if you sound what I've heard, I can't tell you how many times I've been in sessions where I have, Asians are notorious when I work with Asian. Hi, Anthony. Yeah, what do you mean? He's too wooden. Loosen him up a little bit. He's too wooden. I've heard that. I can't tell you how many times. What they mean by that is he basically sounds like, how you doing? The Enterprise rent-a-car guy, what's her name? Elaine's boyfriend from Enterprise, you probably heard me say. He's kind of, what am I talking about? What? You know, he's got that everything straight. And after about four or five clips of that, you know what he does. Okay, that's him. That's his sound. That's great. If we ever need that sound, we know who to go to. But meanwhile, he's not right for this project. Next voice. You got to show a variation on textures, movements, and registers and different tones, but you got to be able to deliver different movement. Your words, when you develop for auditions, just as much as we're talking about demos right now, your producer should strive to force you, if they don't direct you, because most of us don't, we let you run with it and they send us the clips back when we ask for recuts. If we do a session with you and we are going to direct you, you can bet your hands down, bottom dollar, as they say, that I'm going to make you move that thing differently. We call it beats per minute in the music world, all right? Timing. Practice, little bonus thing here, practice with the metronome. You can download it to your iPhone. Get your iPhone out or your Android or whatever you have. Go to Google Play. Get an app installed, the free metronome app, and allow yourself to actually learn how to read two times, different timings. And then turn it up. Then slow it down. And learn how to deliver your voice in a certain cadence. And then learn how to move the voice really quick. Learn how to do cut times. Learn how to do fast reads. Learn how to do slow reads. Then, once you're comfortable with reading slower, moderate, faster, quicker, speedy, then learn how to do what we call word whooping. Learn how to move the waves within the river. If the river is flowing at a certain tempo, there's movement still within that river. It isn't all flowing like a hose where it's all one, you know, coming out at one speed. You got to have movement. And that's what I mean by learn how to move your words like they are musical notes. Learn how to develop tracks that you record for your demo that have life within them, because musical notes have different values of times. Whole note, half note, eighth note, 16th note, 30 seconds, 64. I can go on down if you're musically inclined. You know what I'm saying? If your words are musical notes, because they are musically going to be different, then they should have different times too. They shouldn't all be read exactly the same. Even if I am doing different types of musical notes, I should be able to move my notes like I'm playing an instrument. Part of what talks and what doesn't talk is the ability to, just what I just did there, part of being able to move your words is knowing when to slow down and also knowing how to pick up speed on your words. That creates that rhythm, that cadence. And what that cadence, that rhythm does is it's ear candy to the consumer, right? If not, every song in the world would be the same beats, 4/4, cut time, beats per minute, et cetera. We wouldn't have all these extra timing loops that we do on loops and in the studio. Everything would be the same rhythm, right? Every song would be the same, 4/4 time. All the robotic songs in the world. If you learn to remember, this is both as a bonus little thing to think about as a voice talent, not only in the demo creation, to move your words and think of your lyrics or your copy or your verbiage or your word, your voiceover as notes. So when you are spitting them out, they are like music notes flying out your mouth. Stupid analogy, but you can see a half note, a quarter note, an eighth note flying out your mouth. If you get used to being able to move your dialogue and move your delivery and set a cadence and a pattern, but not be choppy and still remain consistent, you will have flushed the old school way of thinking. And that is, he's not very consistent. If I hear that one more time in my career, she's not very consistent. Can you have her be more consistent? Consistent as what? Robotic? So she just read everything straight ahead and there shouldn't be any stalls. There shouldn't be any movement. There shouldn't be any rhythm. There should be any cadence. There shouldn't be any life. Do you want her to be wooden? You want him to be wooden? That's what I mean by don't be wooden. Allow yourself to move your verbiage. The next thing is be sure to use focus dynamics, important phrases. Make sure that you're saying your words dynamically and you're hitting words they want you to hit dynamically and you're hitting words that are meant to be dynamically delivered. Make sure that they aren't decibly louder, but and they are pitchier, but they're inflected differently so that they have a little bit extra something behind them. What does that do in the demo? That makes your demos 5, 15, 20 second clips, depending on if you do the sizzle version or a full version, and the smaller portion of the clip or the full portion of the clip, it makes each one of those clips pop more. It makes them dance. It makes them dynamically stronger than an average person who puts out an average demo who hasn't been dynamically directed. These are ultimately different elements, you know, that you stack up like we do in our training here at VO101 when I work with people. The intermediate plan, we talk about all those little steps, building those little techniques, so that by the time that you are done, all those techniques are exactly what we build into a demo. And when I work with talent who have not worked with training them, I have to spend time holding their hand prior to building a demo to educate them on why I want dynamics, why I want you to use more than lower register, why I want you to use different tempos, why I want rhythm changes, why I want you to play with textures, why I want you to be airy in one and textury in another, why you're allowed to play with your voice, why. And once the light bulb goes off and they understand how to build the sound of their voice differently, then by the time that we build out a demo, combination of all of the above or a combination of commercials, combination of narratives, they no longer sound like, that's my money voice. And they don't starve to death because they're no longer just a sub shop. Like I say, they're a country buffet. And the reality is once you understand how to use those, you really start to develop a very good ability to do good enunciation. Good enunciation is simply put the ability to make sure demos are enunciated clean, the articulation's there. You can't get away with any demo producer you work with who thinks that you can get away with in a demo environment saying, tuh, and did ya, and hey, man, and whatever weirdnesses, enunciation exercises I can think of for my training with people. No, picture. Picture for yourself. It's P-I-C, picture. Picture for yourself versus picture. Picture you're in the park. Picture? What are they drinking out of a pitcher? Are they drinking out of a pitcher? No, picture all those things we listen for. Professional casting directors, professional evaluators, professionals that really listen to your demo and are considering you for a $90,000 ad campaign. They're not going to hire somebody who can't even say the word picture. Unless they want you to work in a very woke environment and they want you to be very urban sounding, or they want you to be very street, or they want you, or you're doing a boys club or something where they want you to sound like, you know, yo, what's up? You know, they want you to sound that way. Then they'd be directed to loosen up. They may ask you to be slang, be a little bit more. But if you're a professional, then you want to make sure that you enunciate, articulate everything in your demo, not just in your auditions, but in your demo. You want to make sure your demo is clean, articulate, and there aren't any droppages. There aren't any improper enunciated syllables because they will hear them. they will go, what the heck was that? Rewind and go, that's kind of weird. It's a picture. Okay, whatever. So no, you definitely want to make sure that you've got a very good enunciation. Make sure your levels are recorded at consistently, not only in your auditions, little bonus thing here and there, but when I'm developing a demo with you or whoever I work with, if I ever get the honor of doing stuff with you, or you're working with whoever, make sure that producer is making sure if they don't record you in their rig, in their environment, that you send consistently recorded stuff. If not, we have to go through and re-level everything. We have to go through and clean up all the levels, the -3, -6, whatever it produces into. Make sure that you're consistent and make sure that you are consistent in and consistent out. And those of you here and are watching this know how much I'm all about that whole push through tape thing. You know, when you're a track star, what do I tell everybody? The track star could pushing through the tape at the end of the race can be the difference between a world record and a track record and winning the race possibly. Well, in the voice world, we call it petering out. If you look at your wave file and your voice drops off the end, you're basically petering out. You're weak at the end. You're finishing weak. You want to push right through and finish strong because that's the last thing they're going to hear before the next clip. And in the world, that might be the last thing they listen to before the next competitor's advertisement kicks in if you're in the broadcast side of things. So make sure you're consistent, your levels are consistent, your articulation is strong, and make sure that you finish your clips so they start strong and they finish strong. Bookcase them. Why does that make a difference? Well, it makes a big difference when you're doing demos. And I've told people, I need you to record 9, 11, 17, and 24 because they are weak at the end. Finish them strong. So that's the kind of attention detail that a producer should be looking for. Winding down, pick proper, appropriate music and sound effects to establish a great mix and good production value. This assures the prospect can feel your voice and sound in a fully mixed project. Don't bury your sound far in the back, if you will. If you're going to have a good produced mix, that produced mix should be just as important as your voice. If your voice is standing out too far up front, then the whole wow factor disappears. Yeah, they may hear your voice. Yes, they may go, it sounds pretty good, you know, but I don't know. I mean, everything's kind of, if the value is there, the production's there, they've put a little bit of ear candy on your voice. They've thrown a little equalization on your voice. We've thrown a little bit of a high and low or whatever on your voice. And we've played with the voice bit. We put a megaphone phone effect on it or whatever. Producers do that kind of stuff. If your content, your demo has none of the above, obviously it's a straight ahead, conservatively produced studio demo. If it has all that stuff, that's the real world. The real world, they put candy, sound effects, flip through TV channels and watch how many you'll flip. You'll go, I never noticed before. They did put a little bit extra on his voice there and his normal voice. And that is the norm in the business. Producers play with the equalization of the voice. Go as far as allowing yourself to be up front still, but make sure that you're not too far up front to where the mix is like behind you in the background to where you can barely hear it. But we don't mix it so that the mix is also upstaging you. We don't want you to sound like you're lost, but we want the mix to be there. If the music's supposed to be a driving piece and your voice is to complement and drive that home, the music has to complement you. It shouldn't be buried to the point of where we go, where, what is, what's going on? Oh, I hear it now, yeah. And that's basically how a lot of the stuff I hear is weak. And we basically call that weak production. So allow yourself to, don't be afraid to step out in the front, but allow the backup band to be part of the stage. You know what I mean? Don't be an artist who has the band hidden as far back in the stage as they can be. Bring them up front, let them be in the show with you. Let the actual production value stand out with you. And overall, the performance will be that much more enhanced because the music and the sound and everything else will be extra ear candy. But not if it's leveled and mixed right, it can still be very effective. I'm telling you, it can be. Finally, use proper mastering all your demos. Simply put, not too much candy, but yet make sure that you master your stuff to the point of where it's not distorted and it's not overly exaggerated, not too hot, but yet it's good quality levels and good quality mastering. One point that I want to make here is when we master and or when we final a mix, good producers who understand what they're doing will listen to it in different devices. We don't mix based on our $17,000 massive, you know, woofer studio monitors, all right? Because that's not the real world. We mix, and then we mix down to a smaller pair, and we mix down to a smaller bookshelf set. Then we mix to a little bit of a small a consumer-driven PC sound. And that's how a good producer finalizes what is the appropriate level of the final mix for a demo. If you mix for your demo and the demo is mixed only for the studio, most expensive, that average consumers don't have sound, you're getting a deceptive final mix. You're not hearing it mixed in the real world application. Most people have very inexpensive little, their car studio, their car, our car stereo, or they have a couple boom boxes, or they have Logitech $17 speakers connected to their PC, or they're listening through the monitor, has built-in speakers on their laptop. They're not hearing it in the real studios. That can be deceptive if we judge our final mix on just that. In a gaming environment, a lot of kids' TVs are gaming, or they have surround sound as they're gaming. Those are deceptive. Surround sounds put a subwoofer mix in there. They put the Dolby mix in the, it's all deceptive. Your voice talent, you have probably fairly decent little M audio or whoever, Behringer, whatever you're using, small bookshelf, 5 3-inch little monitors that you use, right? All right. Well, that's an appropriate representation of the average consumer. The person who you are potentially going to work for may hear your stuff in their studio, and they may have a cubicle that they do their video mixing in with a couple small little speakers. They may wear headphones. They may be in an environment where they can't blast it because there's 25 other employees in the same room, so they wear their headphones, their earbuds in. You got to mix when you're finalizing so that your mix is such a way that it affects the mix across all those, and it's not hot or soft in either one of those. So when I EQ, when I finally master, people say, well, boy, that my roommate told me that he thinks that's way too loud and too hot. What's your roommate listening to those? Well, he's got a pair of Dr. Dre Beats or whatever he listens to. Come on, really? They're gaming things. I mean, give me a break already. They got Boost and all this extra. Go listen to them on a pair of Logitech, inexpensive consumer studio, marketing director listening to it in her marketing room or his room on a small little pair of speakers that he has plugged into his computer. That's typically what the environment is of most people that really listen. When you're in a studio environment and you're playing and you're listening to them on guns, at cannons as we call them, and you're listening to them, we always have a massive set, right? And then we have that studio monitor shelf set. Then we have a small set. We typically go A, B, C, and we listen to it back and forth. And then we go, yep, that's a good balance for every one of the different devices. There are some devices that can't be overdriven. There are other devices that can't have to have that extra something thrown in. Our goal is to find that happy medium. So if you listen to it and you think that's awfully far off in the distance, go to your car and listen. Go to your living room and listen. Go to your office and put it in your CD drive or DVD drive. Listen to them on your headphones. And then see if they all sound the same and it's all somewhat consistent, then that's why it was delivered that way. But if all of a sudden one is really weak and one is, oh my God, then you know that whoever mixed it really wasn't mixing it for all the different types of formats we put them in out there, devices. That's one of the big things that people don't do, is they don't understand why we mix the way that we mix. It may sound hot for a reason, but it's because some devices, you have to mix it with a little hotter for other devices versus other devices. So the happy medium is somewhere in the middle. Finish off with 3 edits and 3 lengths of each demo, that being a full, a short, and what we call a sizzle. The 60 to 75 second, which started this whole conversation as we come down this home stretch here, was the version that your demo that you're going to give your agent, the 60 or 75, like Pete just got, the sizzle. The reality is the sizzle demo is exactly that. It's for that quick, blow their mind, wow them over, sizzle the brain in their ears in 60 seconds or 75 max. And typically, all agents are happy with that. I'll take that. Okay, that'll work. Thanks. I appreciate it. Typically, it's that speedo, what I call sizzle version. It's a highlight of the entire demo, condensed down, and you're only showing 3 to 5 second bites, give or take. You know, right now is the best time to say, have you ever thought to yourself, tomorrow we are hitting bang, bang, bang. So that by the time that they're done listening to that, that consumer goes, I want to hear, can I hear a little bit more of him? That's what it's all about. Teasing them, the hook. Make them want to go, can I hear a little bit more? Sure. Here's this short version, which is 2 to 3 minutes. Bang. Now they go, they get to hear 10, 12 seconds. Then they typically always go, I think I'll go ahead and hear his full version, especially on your website. Put the full, put the short, and put the sizzle, and let them choose what they want to listen to. If they're in a hurry, they can go right to the sizzle. If they got time, they can hit the middle short version. If they say, I want to hear this guy can stay in a read, I want to hear him and her stay in the pocket, I want to know she can carry the entire read, different ways they'll think of that, say it, then they can hit that full play button. Give them all three options of every one of your demos. Commercial, and I do it with every one of my demo packages. By default, I give a long, then I give a second rendered out short version, then I give a third rendered out sizzle version typically. And I will tell them, these are what they're for. The short sizzle of the sizzle reel is for your agent or for a quick, here's what I sound like overall, montage a lot of times. The short version is for your website and anywhere else you want to attach your email and send it. It gives them pretty good sampling. The long version is for your pay to plays as well. Whatever they want to hear, they can hear because it's like 7 minutes long. The whole point is the long version lets them stay as long as they want. I'll say it like this, why I think that way. If you've got that one opportunity, going back to the old Eminem thing, right? You've got that one opportunity, that one shot, as he says, right? That song is a great song if you ever listen to what he's saying in that song, even though I'm not thrilled with what he's done lately with himself, but the whole idea there is keep them around as long as you can. You don't want them to come and go. You don't want them to show a short version or a really quick speedo and then say, for more, feel reach out to me if you'd like to hear more. They aren't going to hear more. They aren't going to reach out to you. You got to get them while you got them. That's your one shot. Pay and play as much as you can while they are at your disposal. If they want to only hear the sizzle, cool. Hopefully that's the trick. If they want to take the time and go to the short, let them. If by all means they want to take the time and kick back and pop a cap and listen to my whole demo, go for it. It's all there. I know people that have said to me, well, isn't it best just to put the short version there and make them reach out to you to hear the full? Yeah. I understand the mindset behind that, but no. Are you kidding me? First of all, chances are they're not going to be that responsive unless they love what they heard and they blew their mind, the sizzle. They're not going to reach out to you and say, you know what, I just went to your website and I'd like to hear more. How do I get to hear more of your demos? No, they're going to think to themselves, what? Is this all that person has to offer? They want me now to reach out for more demo? What? Give it all to them. Put it all out there. Lay it all out and say, here's everything I can do for you. And if you'd like it, click the free button in the top and I'll be happy to give an audition for free. Bang. Short, a sizzle, short, and a full. If you're working with a producer, I'll close with this thought on this part of it. And the producer says, well, I charge $200 for that mix down. And then I charge $250 more for the edit, whatever. No, it takes us maybe another half hour collectively to edit down three different mixes of that, save as, short, save as, short, save as, sizzle. And then I got three sessions or six or nine, depending on what I built. And it takes me no time to edit down a short and edit down a speedo, a sizzle, and then send those three to you. And you have three in for the price of one. There's no reason that we should nickel and dime talent. At least that's because I'm a talent. I don't believe in that. And demos should have a short enough life shelf with a price tag attached to them that you don't have to mortgage your home or rob your kids' college fund, so that every year you can at least invest in new demos, with the ultimate goal being a master demo package. But down the road, you build off specific targeted genres: automotive only, finance and banking only, technical only, mystery, novel, audiobook only. You get where I'm going. So that when somebody says to you, you know, I'm interested in your automotive, do you have any other automotives than the one or two on your demo? You can go to them and say, yep, actually here's my automotive demo. Or click on my commercial area and you'll see where it says automotives. There's my long, my short, my... And I know people that come to me and they hire me just to build automotive retail. One lady just a couple weeks ago ordered travel. We developed just a travel demo. All she wanted to do was focus on Princess, Royal Caribbean, Disney, Carnival, resorts, like beaches and sandals. And she wanted to focus on that type of getaway because of summer and everything coming. So we built out a demo that was specific to just travel. I had a guy a couple months ago who did the automotive. Before him, I had another lady who wanted to do financial banking type stuff. She wanted, because of Bitcoin becoming so popular and all the Cybercoin stuff, she wanted to be with it, a cutting edge with it, is how she said it. She thinks her daughter was right. She should develop a financial demo that shows her doing banking commercials, credit card commercials, Bitcoin commercials, stockbroker commercials, right? I mean, Swag or Charles, whatever, you know, those type of, and she did an entire commercial geared towards that. So with that in mind, food for thought, demos aren't just category and subcategory specific. They can also be that exact targeted category. And there are times where over your career, just like in characters, I have a monster demo, all right? I have a walla demo that is just me doing sounds, human voices, like, you know, screams and yells and stuff. That's all you'll hear on that demo is just me doing those types of walla sounds or human sounds. I have an automotive demo. I have characters for games. I have characters for children's games. I have mature voices. I have audiobook. I have audiobook narrative. I have a variety of different demos. And that way, over time, going back to when we first started this, invest in yourself, invest in your demos. That's where you're going to potentially return your investment, is the demos that you can put in the market, target specific, genre specific, and a potentially category specific demos. That's why I have, like I said, 50, 60, 65, whatever, up to demos that I rotate in and out all the time, because I have all those demos. If somebody contacts me and says, do you have any character type demos for automotive, but just doing characters? I have a character automotive demo that we can send it in right away. And it shows my different creatures and characters. And, Toyota, you know, whatever character I'm doing, a variety of characters that are used in automotive type ads, if they don't want me to do the actual high energy ad. Heating and air conditioning. I've developed demos that were just specific to air conditioning and heating HVAC companies. This way, if an HVAC company hears me and puts out an audition, I say, here's my audition for you, but also here's a link to, at Voices 123, here's a link to my HVAC demo. And I'm telling you, hands down, it nailed jobs for me over the years. So that's kind of the food for thought, the madness behind putting together a really good quality demo. Know what you're trying to do. Know the subgenres. Understand what categories should be in there. Make sure that you rehearse. Make sure that you own the copy. Consider anything you have on hand. If not, develop good quality stuff. Use your various registers, your tones. Create your clips so that every one of the clips are uniquely different. They're not just one after another. They all sound the same. Make sure they're all uniquely different. Move your words. Allow your tempos. to change and move quicker and slower so that all your individual clips built into a final track that is developed into individual produced clips all have movement and life one after another, are like a roller coaster, and not only musically, but movement tempo-wise. Consistency killed the cat, as they say, or whatever. You know, if you're going to sound consistently the same, and it's going to be you and then a little bit of music, and then you and a little bit of music and a horn, and you and a little bit of music and a cat and a dog. And after about four or five clips, you're going to go, next. But if you wow them over and you hit them and you smack them in the face, and you show them, it's the old shock and awe saying, if you make them wake up for the movement, it's going to make your demo pop compared to everybody else's that's out there. Be sure to focus on your dynamics, hit your dynamics right, use good enunciation, articulation, pick and use the properly mixed music and sound effects and background. And if it's a Civil War type of mix going on, you should be able to hear guns and Civil War ambience in the background. It shouldn't just be a guy going, you know, come down off that horse, Sergeant, with a little bit of old time marching band in the background. It should sound like that was in a game, right? That was actually in an environment that was on camera in a film of the actual scene going on behind them, people falling and stuff. They should be able to see and hear the entire visualization going on behind your audio, what I call soundscape that we create when we build demos. And then make sure you pick the proper music and production value, but make sure that you master right and make sure that the final production has all three edits, a full, a short, and the speedo sizzle that you can give to your agent, or you can use for whatever purposes you want that require just a short sizzle reel type of version. So with that said, I want to go ahead now and see if anybody has questions, and then I'm going to go ahead and do that little drawing like we did last time, and see if I can't give some lucky person an hour of my attention privately via Zoom, doing a private lesson. So let's see, where are we at here? Who we got lined up? We got, okay, Pete, you're first at the top. So you push the buzzer first. Go for it.
Yeah, Anthony, this is a question about a little bit off, but it's about marketing in the 21st century. And it's like, do you favor contacting a prospect and then asking if it's okay to send your demo, your sizzle demo, or do you favor just sending it along and just having a little blurb, you know, underneath that says, I'm really excited about this, I want you to hear it?
Now, are you talking about cold calling are these people you've already have a relationship established?
Some people I have a relationship with, some would be cold. Yeah.
Yeah, if it's a warm list or a hot list, when you're marketing, you should have, as we all should, a hot list. Those are fresh, hot people that we've got in a list. A warm list that are people we've done work with or have shown interest in you, or you have the door open with and it's never been used, but it's there. And then a cold list is somebody who, some people who you maybe know about, you solicit them, they don't really respond, but they've never really asked to unsubscribe, and they're kind of the cold list. Your hot list should be sent out at least every month. Your warm list, probably every other month. I recommend every 60 days. And then that cold list, basically every 90 days. You can set up on your website, Mail Poet and Constant Contact and MailChimp and all these freebie plugins you can get out there that can, you can go and cut and paste and add people into. And then you can send out occasionally, like I do all the time, we do newsletters and stuff, webinar events or whatever. But short and sweet, if they are somebody that you have a door open with, period, then now, and you have a new demo, that is a reason to reach out to them. You want to definitely brag it up and say, I want to let you know, great news, my new demos are ready, or my new demo or whatever. And that's a reason to reach out. What I tell people when I'm doing that marketing and my marketing stuff is, where's the beef? You know, the old, remember the old commercial, the two old ladies and Wendy's, whatever? Where's the beef? You know, well, the whole point is, if you're going to reach out to people, you want to offer them something. It can be a new demo. It can be that you want to offer them a buy one, get free. It can be a, this month I'm offering 1 minute for every minute you purchase. You want to offer them something. So that gives them a reason to respond. If they see there's nothing of value, after two or three or four emails and there's nothing of any worth to them, it's just solicitation, typically they'll just ignore it and they'll just delete you, or they'll write the spam or whatever. Mm-hmm. But if it's something, the subject line gets their attention, new demos I want you to hear. It sounds like, oh, he said it directly to me. I want you to hear, you know, so that it sounds like it's being sent just to them.
Right.
And so the answer is, it's kind of a threefold type of thing. It, depending on your list, who they are and where they're at with your, if you're cold calling on people and you're cold soliciting, you got to be very careful doing that.
Yeah,
if they are obviously in your backyard, they're obviously a studio, they obviously specialize in one of the areas that you market in, typically you can go to their website and they will have a talent submission area.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll have a form or something that you go that way through the side door. You don't necessarily call them and say, yes, my name is so-and-so, and I'm one of 70 zillion voice talent. I know you get calls from, but I'm special. You don't do that these days.
Right,
but
right.
You want to definitely look on their website. It might say for inquiries, talent inquiries, call us at. And then you say, I went to your site. I didn't really see anywhere that I can submit my demo, then that's a different story. It's a shame on them for not offering that, you know, so.
Okay.
Hopefully that gave you a little bit of food.
Great.
Coffee.
Thank you very much.
No problem, man. All right, Carlos, you're next, man.
Yay, thank you. By the way, I came in late. Great thing.
Close up, man. I'm in the lab.
So, as you can see, I'm a guy who makes cookie voices, a lot of energy. I'm just starting out, and I have this idea of actually providing the services for free, you know, for video games or for some Kickstarter campaigns, just to get on my reel and
put on my own demo, you know?
So what do you think about it? Is it something that you would suggest to start just working for free and getting things done in the beginning? Or
what is it? What is you're asking to get on? You're breaking up a lot, so it's hard for us to hear you. What are you asking exactly?
I'm sorry. Yeah, this microphone is kind of crappy. So my question is, do you recommend to start doing works for free at the beginning, just to create your own reel, your own theme, you know, like to get the feel of it?
Yeah, I definitely am a believer in seeing the market. I'm a true believer in going to schools, universities, animation colleges, places where they train people artistically and graphically, and offering through their human resources or their department professor, however you can reach them, and offer them the ability at low dough and or depending for free, your services as a character actor or narrator or broadcaster or whatever. What that does is it potentially sees your future generation of clientele. You know, as we know, the market is constantly entering, new people are entry level and they're coming to work. The people that were at Soylent, for example, that I used to do that with in Britain, they're a university that specializes in dark type of animation, you know, horror stuff and thriller and slasher and all that. And I, for years, worked with her grad students who graduated in their fourth year. I would cast and help them find talent who would work for like $50, and we would do their projects for them. And ultimately, several years later now, some of those talent are in charge of entire departments at animation companies around the world. So yes, there's something to be said about for sure seeing your market. So if that's what you're asking, absolutely, I recommend that highly for sure.
Yeah, thank you.
No problem. All right, man, who's next? Anybody else want to pop any questions quickly before we do the old $1 million raffle here? All right, looks like we're good to go. I changed enough. All right, so here's how we do this. I go ahead and I screen share, and then I will pick this. If I do it right this time, I will pick this app thing that we found on the web a long time ago, and you should be able to And you'll see that basically I can cut and paste all the names of everybody who signed up for the webinar. And I will go ahead and paste all those names. So you'll see all the names pop in there that are here, that were here at the beginning. And Stephen, Howard, Mark, Rob, Jason Y, Eddie, I think that's, how do you say that? Ichukwe, or I'm not sure, I'm sorry about that. Lorenzo, Brian, Derek, Pete, Robert, Raul, David, Jasper, Jim, Tom, Ron, Kim, Carlos, Scott, Gina, Sonia, Jason, L, Pamela, Kathy, Michelle, Devin, Carl, Kevin, Ben, Stephen, Brian M, Laura, Emmanuel, or Manny, I think, and Kelly, and Sophie. Are anybody, am I missing any names on there? No, looks like I got everybody. I don't see any name, hands going up or whatever. So now they're all the names are in there. You see that, right? I didn't like pick and choose. Now we scroll down and basically I tell it to go ahead and magically spin, all right? And what it'll do is it'll magically at this point shuffle the names for me. And then I go down, I click in the middle of the screen there. You see all the names. Everybody's name, so this isn't fixed. And I go ahead and, yeah, go away. What's that all about? And I click spin, and it will spin, and it'll stop. And whoever the lucky $1 million winner is, well, you get what I'm saying. It looks like it is Brian. So Brian looks like Brian's the winner. Brian, you here? Hopefully Brian's here.
You mean me?
It's it. Okay, great. Are you Brian?
I'm Brian, B-R-I-A-N.
So let's scroll down and confirm it right there. Winner, Brian. And there is the winner.
Speechless.
But you can see it officially. All right?
Picture.
So I'll go ahead. Speechless. I know, right? What are you going to do with your $1 million, man?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe just go on holiday. Go back to London and practice my accent.
There you go, man.
This is my real accent. So yeah. Fabulous. Thank you. Thank you, everybody else. Good luck to them the next time. Yeah.
So reach out to me, send an email to support@via101.com, and we'll arrange for me and you to hold a private training session, whatever you want to do with that hour of time with me. It'll always be a little over, but just reach out, send us an email, and we'll make sure to email back. And then me and you can decide what we want to do. But I appreciate everybody being here today. Hopefully you learned something. Remember, if you miss the paper and you want to copy the paper, send the email to support@via101.com. And if you want to take advantage of that $100 savings on a demo package of some sort, feel free to reach out too. And then me and you can talk. And then I can tell you how to take advantage of that $100. But all right. Great talking, everybody. Hopefully this is advantageous for you. See everybody soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Anthony.